a neutron and a beta plus particle, and this is the neutrino. The beta plus particle is a positive electron. Okay? So you have these three decays, and they're called alpha, beta, and gamma. And because the person who first sort of characterized them was Ernest Rutherford, and very gifted physicist from Australia. He then worked in Oxford, at Cambridge, and many people learned from him. And he said he characterized the first radiation, said this is alpha radiation. And the second one he characterized was, he called it beta, because he wanted to have the whole alphabet available to him. And the third one, which is not particles, they called gamma, which we know now are photons, high-energy photons. And so they are also just, the nucleus has, like orbitals, you have here very stable configurations when the orbital is filled, okay? And we are not talking quite about, we're talking actually about shells in the nucleus. There are stable proton shells and stable neutron shells. And when you have a number, these are 2, 8, 20, and so on, if you don't need to memorize this, if you have these, either the proton or the neutron shell has this number of neutrons, a proton, then it's a magic nucleus, okay? It has some added stability. Now we have double magic nuclei. If you have the number of protons and the number of neutrons, have both these numbers here. That doesn't necessarily have to be the same number, but they both have a stable configuration. Then it's called magic. Now let's talk about binding energy. Binding energy is essentially how the nucleus holds its nucleons. That's the binding energy. So when the nucleus is formed, energy is given off, okay? And so the stronger it holds its nuclei, that means the more energy it has given off when it gets formed. So if you have a binding energy per nucleon is the number of protons or neutrons in the nucleus. So you say per nucleon, and this is a mega electron volt, it's an energy. So you have here, for example, hydrogen has one nucleon, okay, this is one proton, has a very low binding energy of about one MeV per nucleon, okay. Now helium has a higher binding energy. Helium has about helium-3, that has helium element number 2, has two protons and one neutron, and this has a binding energy 3 times as strong per nucleon. So they're 3 times as much, a stronger bound than there, and so they released 3 times as much energy per nucleon when this was formed compared to this one. Now if you have lithium has a high binding energy, much higher than helium and hydrogen. So if you could make lithium, for example, by putting helium together in hydrogen, that's called nuclear fusion. You have hydrogen here, helium here. You make lithium, okay? And with this, you form a new nucleus, and with this, you have a very high release of binding energy when this is formed out of these ones, and this is actually real solar energy. That's what happens in our sun. And this is where this high energy from the sun comes from. That's why it's glowing like this. That's why it's heating us. So you get these, it's called fusion, and you have, for example, hydrogen and deuterium makes helium, and it releases a lot of energy. And, of course, it has to be very hot, because you have two positive nuclei. And remember, the probability is very small that these nuclei get close together to make a new nucleus, because you have the Coulomb repulsion. This is positively charged and this is positive, so it can't get together. So if you give it enough kinetic energy, then you have enough probability. Remember the Maxwell distribution? Then you have enough velocity that they can come close to each other statistically, and then they fuse. And so you need 10,000 degrees for this, and this is called a plasma, and this is what the plasma is when you talk about fusion used for energy here on Earth. Fusion energy, you heard that. And so this is what we try to simulate. We try to make this reaction and even this reaction to get a nuclear fusion reaction. Fusion was always out 30 years for me to have it commercially available. When I started as a young man, the plasma, which would enable the nuclei to fuse, was about stable for 10 to minus 18 seconds, 10 to minus 18 of a second. And now it goes close to a second. They are able to have close of a second. This is just in 50 or 40 years. It improved by 17 orders of, or 18 orders of a magnitude. But we need days and years to hold that plasma, to use that energy. And you need to put a lot of energy in to make that plasma. And that means you need to get more out than you put in to use it commercially. And so I think we are still 30 years out. And when I die, we will still be 30 years out. So then you have fission. Fission is uranium. For example, you can fission it. If the uranium catches a neutron, okay, that's fissionable. Uranium-235 is fissionable. It explodes into two lighter nuclei. One is a heavier one and one is a lighter one. And then it releases three more neutrons. Now you have one neutron put in, and you get three neutrons out. So each of these neutrons can now react with one uranium atom. So you get 3 times 3 in the next cycle. And the next cycle, you get a whole avalanche of neutrons. And with this, you have a nuclear explosion. If you don't control the flux of neutrons in a reactor, you control this very carefully, that you don't have a multiplicity of neutrons, that you always have this one neutron. Okay? Now when they fuse together, when they explode, and then reform the krypton and the barium, they release energy. And that energy is fission energy. So this is fission. You see that the lighter ones is not quite as significant as here. The binding energy per nucleon for the uranium is here, and the binding energy for that here for the krypton, for example, is here, or for the barium would be also here. So with this, you have a gain in energy, and this is what is used in nuclear energy and in bombs, okay? So this is a highly exothermic reaction. Wait, there's something missing. Never mind, okay. Where is it? Never mind. Okay, so alpha decay. Remember, we talked about alpha decay is uranium-238, and it spits out, it gives birth to this helium nucleus, this alpha particle. So alpha particle is atomic number 2, and it has nucleons 4, it has 2 protons, and 2 neutrons gives the nucleon number 4. So if it spits this out, if you take 238 minus 4 is 234, that's the nucleon number, and 92 is your atomic mass, minus this alpha that it gives birth to, 92 minus 2 is 90, and element number 90 is thorium. And with this you have a thorium nuclide, and this was an alpha decay. Now we have a beta decay, iodine-131, has a half-life of 8 days, that means after 8 days, one half is gone, and this was a nuclide which was released in Fukushima, for example, but it's also used to treat cancer, thyroid cancer. The first one who discovered the isotope was Glenn T. Seaborg, and the first patient was his mother. She had thyroid cancer, and they treated her for the first time ever with iodine-131, and the electrons destroy essentially the cancer, okay? They bombard the cancer, and with this they destroy the cancer. And so you have a neutron goes over in a proton. If a neutron here goes over, a neutron goes over in a proton, you have then 54, the number of nucleons doesn't change, because neutron and protons are both nucleons, so you have 131 nucleons and 54, and that here, that particle. And so this is the beta minus decay. Now we have the beta plus decay. There is a proton. This is the proton. It's a proton. Decays, converts into a neutron. So proton is 11 protons. One decays. So it goes into 10. So we have element number 10 is neon. Neon is element number 10. So you have neon 22. And you have your beta plus particle. And the beta plus particle is called a positron. And the emission of radiation doesn't stop there. You ever heard of positron emission tomography? That's what this uses. It uses positrons. It gets the compounds that have positrons. Usually they are coupled with monoclonal antibodies. It gets into your brain. They inject it into your brain, not directly in the brain, so the blood stream that goes into your brain. It enriches in the brain. And then it does the following reaction. You have these electrons. They're sitting, these positrons sitting in your brain. And they are, let's forget about this one. These positrons sitting in your brain. And they, of course, we have a very negative world. They see electrons. And when a matter and antimatter meet, they annihilate each other. So E equals M times C squared. Okay? So suddenly the mass gets transformed into energy. And with this, you get 2 gamma quanta, and this annihilates like this. See that? Boom, there they go. There you are. This is annihilation. Let's see which one is our, which one is our, I don't know, this, let's say this one is our, from the right is our positron and from the left is our electron. There they go. And they give off two gamma quanta, okay? Two of them. And in 180 degree direction, and now you can put detectors around there, and wherever it sits in your brain, it's enriched. You can measure the time it takes for one ray to get to the detector and the other ray to the detector, and you have a whole series of detectors. You can put a 2D image essentially onto the body part that you are investigating, and then you can see, this gets stuck there. There's the tumor is right there, okay? And you, this is positron emission tomography, and this is the mass of an electron. The rest mass is this is an AMU. You can say that you have two because two times delta M you can get out. The C square is this here, mega electron volts by divided by AMU, and we know what an AMU is. And with this, you get 1.2 MeV energy from one positron annihilating with one electron. Now, if you have a mole, whole mole of this, you get an energy of 10 to the 11 joules per mole. Now, compare this with the binding energy of atoms of in chemical bonds. The binding energy is 10 to the 5th joule per mole. You see how much higher this energy is? Okay. Now, let's talk about half-life. So, they constantly decay, and half-life is exactly the time after one half of the initial amount is decayed. So, after one half-life, you have one half left. After the next half-life, you have one quarter left. Okay. After the next half-life, you have one eighth left of the initial amount of radioactivity you have. And so this would be here, we measured this in Curie, this would be here, our initial radioactivity. So now we have strontium. That strontium has a half-life, if I recall right, of 29 years. Yeah, thanks God. It's 29 years. So after one half-life, if you have one half, this would be 50% is decayed. Now we go another half-life, we get to here, okay? Another half-life would be another 29 years. Come on, okay? Another half-life would be another 29 years, and another half-life would be another 29 years, another half-life would be another 29 years. So this is an exponential decay. You see that? That's an exponential decay. And exponential decays, you can word like this. N is the number of atoms at the time t. That would be this time here if I want to calculate. It's the number of initial atoms, N0, times e to the minus lambda t. Or k in your book. It's called k in your book. And k is the decay constant. It's specific for each specific isotope. It's what decay it has. It's been measured. This one has this kind of a decay constant. If you take the logarithm, you put this over here, you take the natural logarithm over this, you get this ln nt divided by N0 is minus lambda t. Okay? And so t1/2 is ln 2 divided by lambda. Okay? And that's what you need to know. The half-life is t1/2 is ln 2 divided by the constant. So if you have that constant, you can always get the half-life. So after 10 half-lives, you're about to 1 in 1,000 decay. 10 half-lives. So if your isotope iodine-131, which was a part in Fukushima, is an 8-day half-life, after 80 days, you have 0.1% left, or 0.001 of the initial amount. All right? So let me ask you a question. We have a tritium. This is tritium. It's a radioactive element. And this is used now to illuminate dials, okay? And we have, this was manufactured, that dial was manufactured in 1988. Now is, if I'm correct, 2012. So you can know how many years it is since then. And it is now, it has one-fourth of its original intensity. One-fourth of its original, I'll give you this here in case that you need that here. One-fourth of its original intensity. What is the half-life of tritium? Is it 6 years, 12 years, or 24 years? Please, try to answer that. How many years have passed since 1988? Then you can say, if one-fourth is left, you can say how many half-lives it was. What's the answer? Yeah, good. That's an easy one, but you also can calculate it. You can deduce it with logic, or you can calculate it. If you want to calculate it, you use that equation here. Okay, let's see. How are we doing? Half-life concept understood. Excellent. Thank you. Thank you. All but only success. So that's the relation since 88, one fourth is twice one half, okay, squared. And this is two half-lives in 24 years. That means it is 12 years. Or you can do it like this. N over T, N at the times T over N0 is minus lambda T, and T1/2 is ln 2 to lambda. So you get what lambda is, okay, or you put directly T1/2 is there. L from 1 over 4, okay, you have 1/4 left, is minus ln 2 divided by the time, that is T times the time, that is 24, divided by T1/2. If you bring this over, you get 12 years out of this, okay? This is something you need to sort of calculate a little bit, especially, never mind. Okay, so 12 years. Now let's do another one. We have an alpha, and let me go back to the other screen. We have an alpha decay of plutonium-239. That's plutonium-239 decays by alpha decay to what? To plutonium-235, neptunium-235, or uranium-235. Alpha decay. So everything you need to know, here's the alpha decay, and the alpha decay is this here, obviously. So you need to subtract or add something, and then you get the answer. Why don't you think about this and give me a solution, please? It's right here. You don't have to even look there. That's right. I gave it to you right there. That's the actinides. No stanfordium. Okay? Berkelium, right there. Okay, alpha decay understood. Excellent. We're moving right along, of course. If you subtract the helium nucleus from this, you have 239. It's 2, 4, 239 minus 4 is 235, something 235. But you have element number 94 minus 2 gives element number 92, and element number 92 must be uranium. I hope I'm correct. Okay. All right, there you go. That's the alpha decay, so you subtract that out. This is 239 minus 4 is 235, 94 minus 2 is 92, element number 92 is uranium, 235. Okay, and this was your answer. And because it's so much fun, we do another one. Or at least I will display it to you. That's what I did this morning. So that's something. What are the products of the following beta decays? Sodium 22 emits a beta minus particle. What do I get? And sodium 22 emits a beta plus particle. What do I get? Is this the combination? This the combination? This the combination? I won't have time to do this, but officially this was my last lecture today, my last lecture for Chem 1A since 8 years. For a long time, I will be teaching 20 people. I thank you for your. Thank you for your patience with me when I misspoke sometimes. It was a tremendous pleasure to teach you. I hope, I wish you all the best, and also cross your fingers for the final, okay? All right, take care, bye-bye.